Hi, I am Professor Tian. I am a macroeconomist. I'd like to talk to you about money in this short video. Who doesn't like to talk about money?
Specifically, we will cover the economist's definition of money and go over different types of money as well as the functions of money. Money, from the economist's perspective, is anything that is generally accepted as payment for goods or services or in the repayment of debts. Why do economists care about money? Without money, we cannot conduct economic transactions. So money is intricately linked to changes in macroeconomic variables that affect all of us and are important to the health of the economy. These days, with all the new financial innovations, you have all sorts of options for making payments: credit cards, Apple Pay, Venmo, etc. These different payment options do not necessarily fit the economist's definition of money. So I'd like you to just focus on the physical form of money for now, such as the paper bills and coins you can hold in your hands and give to someone in exchange for goods and services. This will help you understand the concept of money better without getting distracted or confused by alternative payment methods that may or may not be money. Let's start by looking at some money. Here we have pictures of many different currencies, from US dollars and British pounds to euros and Canadian dollars. These paper bills are what economists call fiat money, or currency. It's fiat money because these pieces of paper have no intrinsic value. We accept it as payment for goods and services because the government said that they are legal tender and we must. But money can actually take on a lot of different forms. Shells were used as money in ancient times in different continents. Metal coins like gold and silver were used in the Middle Ages. In prisons, where cash is not allowed, stamps, cigarettes, and even ramen noodle packs can act as money for prisoners to conduct transactions amongst themselves. These types of money are what we call commodity money, because the objects being used as money have intrinsic value. You can use shells or gold or silver to make beautiful jewelry. You can smoke the cigarettes and eat the ramen. Now that we have defined what money is and learned the differences between fiat and commodity money, let's talk about the characteristics or functions of money. First, ask yourself this question: what do I use money for? The first answer that likely pops up in your head is that you use money to buy stuff. So one of the main functions of money is that it is a means of payment or medium of exchange. Can you imagine a world without money? How would you carry out transactions? In the ancient times when there was no money, people bartered with each other. Let's say I'm good at growing vegetables and have a big vegetable garden, but I don't have any cows and want some milk. How can I get my hands on some milk? I can take my extra vegetables and try to exchange them with someone who owns cows and has fresh milk to offer. But this requires a double coincidence of wants, meaning that in order for this trade to take place, the dairy farmer with milk has to want my vegetables. If they want fruits instead of vegetables, then the trade can't happen. The presence of money magically solves this problem. It makes conducting transactions much more efficient. I can sell my vegetables for some shells, and the dairy farmer can sell their milk for some shells as well. We can then use the shell money we have to get whatever we want in the market. Clearly, a lot more economic transactions can happen with the presence of money, since we don't have to search for a matching trading partner anymore. It would not have been possible to grow our economies or develop the kind of complex and physically dispersed economies we live in without money. Now, besides using money as a means of payment, what else do we use money for? If you just look around you, the chair you are sitting on, the clothes you are wearing, the pen you are using, even the education you are getting has value, and that value is often expressed in dollars and cents. In other words, expressed in terms of money. So money acts as a unit of account. We use it to quote prices of everything we buy and sell. In addition to that, we can also use it to record debts, loans, or assets. Just like using pounds or kilograms as the standard measurement for weight, money can be considered a standard measurement for value. Having a standardized unit of account is incredibly convenient in terms of transmitting price information to ensure that economic resources are allocated efficiently. Imagine if goods are quoted in different units of measurements instead of being quoted in dollar terms. For example, if a loaf of bread is worth 4 bars of chocolate, a bar of chocolate is worth 2 tomatoes, and a tomato is worth half an avocado. If I ask you to figure out the relative value of bread versus avocado, you will need to do a couple of conversions in order to calculate that a loaf of bread is actually worth 4 avocados. But if all the items are quoted in terms of money or dollars in the correct relative value, then a loaf of bread would be $4 and an avocado would be $1. It now takes you no time at all to figure out that a loaf of bread is worth 4 avocados. Finally, one important function of money that we cannot overlook is that it is a store of value. For money to function as a means of payment, it should retain its worth for an extended period of time. Consider countries like Argentina or Zimbabwe that have suffered through episodes of hyperinflation. Hyperinflation means that inflation rates are higher than 50% a month. In these countries, people often abandon their fiat currency and turn back to the barter system of trading because the high rates of inflation erodes the value of the fiat money too quickly. For example, if the $100 you hold can get you 10 loaves of bread in the morning, but only one loaf of bread in the evening because of rising prices, what do you think you would do with your money? You would spend it as quickly as possible, of course. Under the circumstances, would you prefer to get paid in fiat money or in loaves of bread? If the fiat money is worth nothing by the end of the day, then loaves of bread would probably be a better option. Now, remember I asked you earlier to focus just on the physical form of money that we can use to conduct transactions? I know that's a lot to ask, since most of us hardly use cash these days to conduct transactions. So let's come back to that. Financial innovations allow us to make purchases without carrying cash around now. But are credit cards, Apple Pay, Google Pay, or Venmo considered money? Credit cards are not money. It is a way for you to delay payment on goods and services you purchased. At the end of the month, when your credit card bill comes along, you still need to use the physical money that sits in your bank account to pay the credit card companies for the credit that they offered you by using your cards. Similarly, Apple Pay, Google Pay, or Venmo are payment services that are either linked to your credit cards or to your bank accounts. So they aren't money either, for the same reason why credit cards are not money. Only the physical money that sits in your bank account counts as money. To sum up our discussion, money is anything that can be used as payment for goods and services or in repayment of debt, and it functions as a medium of exchange, a unit of account, and a store of value. Payment services like credit cards can help you make purchases, but they are not money.
I hope you now have a much better understanding of what money really is and how money allows for us to have the kind of vibrant and diverse economies we enjoy today.